Games like Stardew Valley really show off some awesome pixel art, including the used pixel art font. In this tutorial, I'd like to show you how you can create your own pixel art font and use it, for example, in your Unity game. So here we are in the Unity game view, and on the right side you see the result of this tutorial. A nice crisp pixel art font with an optional shadow underlay. On the left side we have the same font, but with different settings, which can result in washed out font sizes or even some bad distortions. All the way to the left, here in the scene view, you see how nicely the font is aligned to this pixel art UI frame. And if I zoom in a little bit further, you see the grid, and the Unity project is set up in a way that this grid represents the pixel grid. So it is very nicely aligned to this pixel grid. And this is also the case for the smallest font size. So first the outline. In part 1 we create our SVG character font files. In part 2 we use them to create in FontForge our TTF font file. And in part 3 we jump into Unity and create our TextMesh Pro font asset. And in part 4 I show you some scaling tricks so you can make sure that your pixel art font stays always crisp. Regarding the use programs, in part 1 and 2 we are using Inkscape and FontForge. Both are free and you can donate if you want to support the development of these programs. In part 3 and 4 we are using Unity. Links to all the programs and the versions are in the descriptions. All of them are running under macOS and Windows, and in the descriptions are also some links to sources that I found really helpful when I created this tutorial. So let us start with part 1. For the first thing that we need to do, we open FontForge, and the important thing we need to determine for our font is how the native font size will be for our pixel art font. If you open FontForge for the first time, you should see this window. If this window is not visible for you, it can be that it is on some kind of a phantom monitor for a multiple monitor setup. So use the Windows, the Shift key and the arrow keys to move the active window around between your monitors. Then we go on New in FontForge, and here I just want to show you how FontForge looks. So we have here character containers for each of these characters for the font, and I prepared in Inkscape sketch. So we go to Inkscape. Here I have enabled this EM square layer that I prepared, and let me show you this little sketch the beginning so I can explain why this native size is important. So the characters of FontForge are built up like this sketch. So we have an ascent area above the baseline and the descent area below the baseline. So this here represents one of these containers here. So the first thing we need to determine is the M size, which is the native size of the font or the height of the font. If you want to have more in-depth information about this EM square, you can go on a website called Design with FontForge, and I leave a link for this in the description as well. So for the first thing to determine this native size of our font, we just play around a bit, experiment and draw a few characters. So let me disable this. So you go to Inkscape, and if you open Inkscape for the first time, it should look like this. So to set everything up for pixel art, you go to File, Document Properties, and then we change the display units to pixel, and also the units for the output window, which is this one here, also the pixel. And we also change the size to something smaller, so for example 20 by 20 pixel. In this window we will put our characters for the font. Since we don't know the size yet, we just assume something small. We can change this always later in the process. So I close this. Second thing, we need to make the page grid visible. You can go View and Page Grid or hit the number sign. Then I zoom in by holding Control and the mouse wheel, and to move around in Inkscape you can click your mouse wheel and move your mouse. And the last setting that we need to set up is the snapping. So on the right side you have all your snapping settings. The important ones are that the snapping is turned on. So here is the global enabling and disabling button. And here are the snapping setting that we need. There are the snap to the cusp nodes and the snap to the grid. So in that way, our objects are snapping to this pixel grid. So we save this. I save it on a desktop and I create a new, oh, here's my previous folder. I just delete it. So we have a fresh new one. So I create a new folder called my pixel art font, and we will use this folder for the whole tutorial, and I will save all the files into this folder. Okay, so the first thing we do is go and enable the layer property, or enable the layer window by using this button here, and also make the fill and stroke window visible. So at the beginning, we create a new layer. I call it crisp template. And on this layer, I use the text field tool and just write in this text field with a known font. In this case, the font is called Verdana. We can see this by let us show the font properties to have this font window as some kind of a template for our pixel art font creation. So I create also a second layer called crisp pixel art. And what we're going to do is we create a few characters of this word crisp. So I'm now in this layer and we are using the rect tool by clicking this button. And now you see how the rect tool snaps to the intersections of this grid. So if I now zoom in and I click, drag and let loose, and you see that the rectangle has rounded corners, and that's why this tool is set up in that way. So I press F2 again. So F1, it looks like this. And if we press F2, we have here this node that we can manipulate. I take this node and move it up. So we have now sharp edges. And another thing that we want to get rid of is the stroke. So we go to the fill and stroke properties window, stroke paint, disable it, and the filling we are making it black. And now we have a pixel that we can draw with. So how do we do this? I select the pixel, hit Control and then C. And now I just hover over these tiles and then I paste all the rectangles over these tiles. And in that way we draw pixel art in Inkscape. And all these are vector based, and that's really handy and what we all need for the next step for part two. So for this process, just take yourself some time, experiment a bit, play around with different font styles and sizes, and eventually you will come up with something that suits you, your style, for your program or for your game. You can even very easily import image files, so PNGs, for example, into Inkscape via drag and drop, if you want to have your font relative to some of your game elements or your program's UI elements. So for now, we just leave it with the capital letter C and small letter R. I already prepared the other characters that I show you in a minute. And what I will show you now is another template I prepared. Here are other characters and also a number and symbols, also in this Verdana font, and corresponding the pixel art characters for this. So how do we determine now the native size of our font? So the main or the important character parameter here, sorry, is the height. So I created also according to these pixel art fonts a guideline layer just using the rectangle tool in different colors. And you need to have the size of your tallest character. For example, in this case, it would be the German capital letter A, or for example, the single quote, and your lowest character, here the small letter Y. And now we just count the pixels. So for the decent area, the gray area, we have 1, 2, 3 pixels. And for the accent area, everything above the baseline, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pixels. And with that information, we can now fill out our EM square sketch, and because we need these values then in part two, when we create our font with FontForge. So we have 9 and 3, and these add up to a native size or EM size for our font for 12 pixels, of 12 pixels. And this value, by the way, if you go, for example, on websites like DaFont, which provide already bitmap or pixel fonts that you can download, but check always the license agreement, in which case you can use them. And you see here these values, and these are the native sizes. So in our case, it would be 12 pixel. So if we now take our created capital letters C and R, I just marked them and just drag them over here. And one thing that's special in Inkscape is that even if I'm not on the layer where these elements are on, I can still select them. So all layers in Inkscape are selectable, except when they are locked or when they are not visible. So that's something specific to Inkscape. Just keep that in mind. So now we have our elements here. And you see here capital letter M is a little bit larger than the capital letter C. So I bump it up by 1 pixel so that it aligns a little bit better in our font. And this is the way how you go when you create your pixel font. You do a few character combinations, write a few words, try out things, and then you come up with a size that's very pleasing for you. You see the smaller R fits right into all the other small characters. A short out view. I have here pixel added, and the first font I created was an 8 pixel native size font. And you see here it looks much more bold. The degree of detail is much lower. And this, I didn't like it with the small letter E. So that's why I went to a native size of 12 pixels. So you might ask, why don't we use this pixel edit program? It's dedicated only for pixel art. You can animate things in here and use tiles. Yeah, the problem is in pixel edit, we cannot export all the layers to single SVG files. You could, if you want, export these layers to single PNG files and then drag and drop them into Inkscape. And in Inkscape, you can then convert them to vectorized objects. But this takes much more time, I think, than just create yourself a small rectangle pixel and draw your pixel characters while hovering over the grid and copy paste them. So that's why I used Inkscape. Now we have this information all set up. Next thing we're gonna do is put our characters on single layers. I already started it here to make the video not too long. But one thing I want to point out is create yourself a separate layer called, for example, EM square guideline. And on this layer, you could, for example, use your guideline that came out of your creation process. Put it on this layer, and then you want to move it in your output window, just as the guideline when you align all the single characters on the layers. Maybe we make it a bit narrower, for example, 12 pixels as well. And since we know our native size, the EM size, the height of our font, I go to document properties and change the height of our output window to 12 as well. And for the width will be set separately for each character in FontForge. So in part two, we will do this. And the way we do this, or the way you need to keep this in mind, is you have the width of the character itself, and then the spacing between the neighbor character. So for example, for the period would have a width of 2 pixels. So one for the pixel, for the period itself, and one for the spacing. So keep that in mind when you set up the width of your output window, because it should be as wide as your widest character or symbol. For example, in this font, it would be maybe the number sign, which is quite wide. And another thing that I would recommend, if you use, for example, this font in a game, then make sure that the width of your digits or numbers is equal. So I've here in this case, it would be 4 pixels for each, or 5 with the spacing. And then if you have, for example, a counter in your game, the whole number always is the same size because the single digits have all the same size. So that's very handy. Okay, then let us now take our capital letter C and the small letter R and create separate layouts for them. So for the capital letter C, I name it C and two large C's because the output-export process is not case sensitive. So it would override the small letter C if I just would differentiate them by small and capital letter. That's why I also used a small letter C at the beginning of the capital letter M. Then next we take our capital letter C, I copy it, change to this newly created layer, and then I align it in this output window. And you need to align it all the way to the left of this output window and also according to this baseline. So this is really important. So if I, for example, change to the small letter Y, you see here how it is aligned as well to the baseline. That's very important before exporting them to SVG layers. Another important thing is, let me change to this layer again. I just lock our EM square guideline layer. So when I now want to select all the objects of the capital letter C, I don't accidentally select the layer as well. You can see this here. Now I lock it again and now it's not selectable because we need to unionize all the pixels of this capital letter C or of each character so that we only have one object. So you go to path and then union or click control and plus on your keyboard. And now we have just one object. And you need to do this for all characters. That's very important. Otherwise we get some errors in FontForge when we are in part two. So let me do this for the small letter R as well. So just align it, put it on its dedicated layer, mark everything, and then control plus to union. Okay, very nice. For the unionize process, make also sure, for example, for these letters or for the small letter I, that you include these separate pixels as well, so that it's the whole character is just one object. And the unionized process must also be applied to the period, because otherwise we get some errors. How these errors will look like, I show you this as an example in part two. Now we are good and set up for export everything to SVG files. So we go to File and then Save a Copy. Now we navigate to the desktop, to our created folder, and now we choose Layers as separate SVG, and this will create an entire archive file. So we leave the name as is, save, and now we change to our folder on the desktop. Let me move this aside. So the window is here. Okay, and here we have our tar archive file. So to extract them, you can use 7-zip or WinRAR. I use 7-zip here, link is in the description. And I choose extract to a separate folder. So it will create a separate folder out of this archive. And then in this folder, we have all our single SVG files from our layers. So we have also this prepared layers, but we can ignore them for now. So if I would, for example, now open the layer for the small letter C, so the SVG file, it would open this Inkscape file. And you see here, nothing is visible, but our output window size is as that what we said it is. So we have here 5 pixels, 5, 10 pixels, and 2, 12. And you can see here also the layer. So yeah, keep in mind that Inkscape remembers the layer settings, so if a layer was hidden when you exported it, it would also be hidden in the single SVG file. Okay, that looks very nice. And yeah, that's it with part one. In part two, we take all of these layers and put them in the character containers in FontForge. And until then, I hope I could help you with this tutorial. Please leave a like. Thank you very much for watching. And don't hesitate to comment or subscribe to my channel. It would really help me out. So thank you very much and goodbye.